war has no boundaries. From Siberia to the Alps, when the lead starts flying, you better be ready, or you better bug out. That's why armies field extreme troops. From Arctic warfare to elite mountain kata, these sub-zero heroes take whatever Mother Nature throws at them and spit it right back.
What we really have are guys who are prepared to go anywhere, anytime, and use their warfighting skills while capitalizing on the terrain they find.
Get up the rail!
It's time to ice and dice as we go back through generations of technology to trace the evolution of this elite fighting force, Extreme Warriors. It's time to go ballistic.
Come on, you bunch of red brothers!
Every army in the world fields extreme warriors. Arctic wastelands, mountain passes, high altitude, extreme cold. These aren't jobs for conventional troops.
Extreme warfare is warfare that's sub-zero. This is warfare that's 15,000 feet above sea level. This is warfare that makes the ultimate demand on the people that fight it.
In World War II, America's 10th Mountain Division were deployed to the Italian Alps, driving back the Germans. In Russia, brutal sub-zero warfare resulted in the Germans taking a beating. And today, extreme warriors are taking on the Taliban and some of the highest terrain on Earth in Afghanistan.
The mountains over there can be a little intimidating. They're very jagged and rough. There's a lot of wind, and the thunderstorms are very intense, the most lightning I've ever seen.
Extreme warriors are the elite of the elite, specially selected from units like the SEALs, the United States Marine Corps, the SAS, and the Royal Marine Commandos.
This is harsh, harsh, harsh environment, so if they need somebody to do something right, this will be the battalion they call. Let's go.
Mountain troops get vertical with specialist climbing equipment and are deployed in high-altitude Black Hawk UH-60s. Arctic forces hit the slopes on skis and pack serious firepower with the Accuracy International Arctic Warfare Sniper Rifle. Together, these elite forces are ready to rock in the wildest environments. Now, weaponology will unlock the Extreme Warriors family tree, traveling back through history to reveal how helicopters, ropes, rifles, and skis have transformed Arctic and mountain warfare. The origins of extreme warfare are as old as the hills themselves. In 218 BC, Hannibal defeated the Roman army by advancing over the Alps and taking them by surprise.
He had specialized troops from mountainous areas who would actually go up the mountains to secure the way ahead of his troops as they advanced.
Fast forward almost 2,000 years to the 20th century. It's a period of sustained global conflict. In Europe, mountains still echo to the sound of battle. And way down below, frozen landscapes are scarred by men and machines. It's a time when the first extreme units are formed. A time when mountain and Arctic warfare become a necessity. During World War II, the Germans developed an elite mountain division, the Gebirgsjäger.
When Hitler started to rebuild the German army in the 1930s, one of the units that he created was the German Mountain Division.
Their insignia was the Edelweiss. New recruits would often complete their training by picking this mountain flower from its high altitude habitat. It was proof that they were tough and ready.
The German Gebirgsjäger were the elite in military mountaineering. They had more mountaineering experience than anywhere else in the world.
They also had the first rifle specifically designed for mountain troops. The semi-automatic Gewehr 43 would give the Gebirgsjäger a lightweight firearm with a heavyweight punch.
The burden on troops in cold weather or mountainous environments is much greater. So anything you can do to lighten their load or lighten their burden is a plus. And that's why this weapon was developed.
At 44 inches, the weapon was short and easy to handle. German weaponologists also stripped the rifle of any excess weight.
Notice even the bolts lightened. A hole in the bolt was drilled to lighten the load for the mountain soldier.
The weapon also had another unique feature. When it wasn't firing, it could be used as a climbing aid.
It has a little butt shield right here to protect the stock when the troops were using it as a climbing stick, essentially going up the mountains.
The German 1st Mountain Division were considered an elite force of World War II. But it was another, smaller nation that proved themselves the masters of extreme warfare. In November 1939, the Soviets invaded Finland. An invasion force of over a million men, thousands of tanks, and hundreds of heavy guns were getting ready to flatten the Finns.
Early winter had set in, and out of the forests of the south of Finland, dressed in camouflage whites on skis and snowshoes, came the Finns.
Hugely outnumbered, the Finns used the Arctic environment to their advantage. Crucial to their success would be their cross-country skis.
The Finns formed small ski detachments. They were able to cross ground quickly. They could hit and run against much larger Russian formations and then be away before the Russians were able to organize themselves to respond.
They became the silent death. They became people who'd materialize almost invisible against the snow behind them, and they'd kill and go away.
One man typified the extreme warrior spirit of the Finns. Simo Heha. Nicknamed the White Death by the Soviet Army, this 5-foot farmer would become a giant in sniping history.
Most snipers won't kill more than 5 or 10 people in their entire career. Heha is credited with more than 500 kills, working in temperatures down to minus 20, minus 30. In those conditions, a quite extraordinary achievement.
Heha's awesome body count was made in just 100 days of active service, an average of 5 kills a day. Ironically, Heha's weapon of choice was a Finnish M28, a variant of the Soviet Mosin-Nagant rifle. Incredibly, he preferred to use the basic iron sights on the rifle instead of adding a telescopic lens.
Unusually for a sniper, Heha used the iron sights on his rifle, i.e. the standard sights which are built into it. He decided against using a scope, partly because in the extreme cold it would fog up, but also because a scope can catch the sunlight and give away your position.
Heha's reign of terror was eventually ended by an exploding Soviet bullet. The Finn's lower jaw was ripped off. Incredibly, he survived, and woke from his coma to discover that the Soviets had retreated. Stalin's army had lost hundreds of thousands of men.
What the Finns had done that winter was noticed militarily everywhere.
Around the world, armies began pouring resources into Arctic and mountain troops. Weapons and training would become crucial to their survival. To fight through the harshest environments on the planet, you need men of steel. Units that can push through snow, scale mountains, and send the enemy to hell. To achieve their missions, these extreme warriors will need more than just an iron resolve. They'll need some extreme firepower. Facing the issue of near impenetrable terrain, mountain troops used small, easily dismantled and reassembled portable howitzers to punch holes in mountain defenses.
They needed weapons that could be broken down and then put on animals to be packed up mountains and high passes and all that. So this howitzer was developed for that kind of war.
The Germans favored the 75-millimeter infantry howitzer, capable of being broken down into six loads of 165 pounds. It fired a 12-pound high explosive shell. Like all howitzers, its short barrel could go vertical to lob shells over mountain obstacles, or it could go horizontal for ground combat.
A howitzer is a combination of a gun and a mortar. A mortar lofts around at a very high trajectory. A gun fires at a very flat trajectory. A howitzer, you can do both.
The lethality of this weapon, combined with the impenetrable mountain passes, made life hell on the Italian front.
Italy's mountain spine favored defense, and the Germans fought tenaciously for each crag and peak. Every hill village became a citadel, every cave a machine gun nest.
Removing the Germans would be a task for specialized units. Units like America's 10th Mountain Division.
This is the story of one of America's most unusual fighting outfits, the 10th Mountain Division.
Before World War II, the U.S. didn't have Arctic or mountain troops. They hadn't needed any. But now, with Hitler rampaging through Europe, they had to evolve.
The Army Chief of Staff gave an order to create a 1,000-man experimental unit, and its purpose was to put to a test this whole concept of mountain soldiers in our Army.
The 10th recruited proficient skiers and climbers. As skiing was an expensive, elitist sport in the U.S., most of the division were highly educated college men.
We had one of the highest IQ divisions, if not the highest IQ division in the whole Army.
These men would need more than just brains when they went up against the Germans in Italy. They had to train their bodies to survive on mountains and in freezing temperatures.
They had to be trained differently to operate in sort of a subarctic environment. Otherwise, they'd die.
The 10th would also have to fight in impossible conditions. Waging war on skis and fighting up mountains is no cakewalk.
They had access to a knowledge that allowed them to put terrain on their side rather than the mountains becoming yet another enemy.
The 10th Mountain Division were ready. It was time to kick the Germans out of Italy. February 1945, and the 10th Mountain Division are preparing to assault Mount Belvedere. Up above them, the German artillery are trained in on every accessible path. It's got all the makings of a massacre. U.S. commanders are forced to make an extraordinary decision. The 10th are ordered to empty the bullets from their weapons and told to advance on German positions in total silence.
We were told not to load our weapons because if we fired either accidentally or on purpose, it would indicate they were under attack.
It's a ballsy plan. If the 10th can sneak up the mountain undetected, they'll be so close to the Germans that their artillery and guns will be useless.
The soldiers didn't really like the idea of going into battle without the ability to shoot back, but the important piece was to be silent.
So we were moving with unloaded weapons at night in unfamiliar country.
The Germans were oblivious to the men of the 10th as they silently edged towards their positions. It was a gutsy play that could have ended in tragedy, but the boys of the 10th had the right stuff. Loading their weapons at the last moment, they tore into the German lines.
With the 10th Mountain Division coming up silently at night, they were able to surprise the German troops and boot them off the hill.
When the 10th were allowed to attack fully loaded, they were even deadlier. One of their favorite weapons was the standard-issue grease gun.
During the Second World War, most of the contending forces produced a short, stubby, fully automatic pistol caliber submachine gun. And in the American case, it was the M3 grease gun.
A fully automatic submachine gun with a 30-round mag. It was good for close-in mountain fighting.
It had lots of stopping power because of that big 4-5 round, and it was a weapon which, at close range, had few equals.
Hugh Evans used his to devastating effect during the Battle of Belvedere, when the loss of a close friend made him see red.
I came upon my platoon sergeant. He had been shot through the chest, and he died more or less in my arms. I was angry. I was really angry.
Lost in a violent rage, Hugh ran toward the German lines. He lobbed a grenade into a trench, killing two men. In the confusion, he found another German aiming straight at him.
A German popped up in front of me, and I had my grease gun at ready and killed him, and then ran down and jumped into that trench. And there were two other Germans in that trench manning a light machine gun, and they surrendered to me.
Assuming these feats must have been achieved by more than one man, many of the Germans turned and fled.
Some of them tried to escape running down the hill, and I turned their own machine gun on them.
Before he knew it, half the German division started surrendering to him.
Germans came up with their hands from all over the place, their foxholes being so well camouflaged you couldn't see them.
Hugh and his grease gun had just pulled off a miracle. Mount Belvedere would become a legend in mountain warfare.
It became obvious to both American and German commanders that the 10th was no ordinary combat outfit.
light, portable weapons are crucial when mountain troops go toe-to-toe. At longer ranges, they need heavier, more accurate firearms. Enter the world of the mountain sniper. In the 21st century, he operates in the cold, barren mountains of Afghanistan. It's an environment that brings unique challenges.
A place like Afghanistan are proving to be a real problem for sniping. Because you're so high or you're so low shooting up, the bullet's going to do something different. So a thing the snipers are having to learn now is the angled shooting.
The mountain sniper isn't just fighting the enemy, he's fighting physics.
One of the important things to remember is that your normal trajectory of the bullet is not going to hold consistent when we start talking about extreme angles, and that has a dramatic effect.
On a level plane, a shot can be calculated easily, but at elevations, trigonometry kicks in. The height of the sniper's firing from and the distance to the target have to be accurately gauged. Put simply, A plus B equals see you later. To test this theory, Rob is replicating one of the most difficult shots a sniper could take. He will aim for a target in the canyon below, 500 yards away.
Approximately 20 degrees.
He has to take account of not only the extreme angle of the shot, but also the wind and temperature at this altitude.
Clear.
Target, report the shot location.
Shot location is in the high left chest, about 2 inches to the left of the buttonhole in the pocket on the left chest.
Taken from a craggy outcrop above the canyon, Rob achieved a clean shot. A perfect example of extreme sniping. But being able to target and kill your enemy is only half the battle in these types of terrain. It's getting there and back that's the hard part.
The concept of being caught by something this thin would probably break your back if you fell much more than about 10 or 15 feet.
Extreme warriors take it to the max. Skiing, climbing, rappelling, they're adrenaline junkies with guns and attitude. In the last century, elite soldiers have been deployed to some of the most inhospitable hellholes in the history of warfare. In Afghanistan, Special Forces mountain troops face the awesome task of evicting Osama bin Laden from his Tora Bora cave system. At 13,000 feet, no easy task. Facing sheer cliffs and near impregnable Taliban positions, they turn to one of the oldest bits of kit in their locker, ropes. Their use militarily can be traced back to Alexander the Great in the 4th century BC.
The first recorded use of mountaineering skills to go up a rock face is actually for a military purpose, and it was part of Alexander's campaigns through the Middle East when he had 200 of his men attempt to ascend a rock face, and over 100 of them made it to the top.
Alexander's fearless mountain warriors took the enemy completely by surprise, using ropes and small iron tent pegs to scale the rock face.
They climbed up the face of this mountain at night and actually just astounded the enemy by being up there when the sun came up.
A classic Special Forces op. Alexander's troops put the enemy to flight and won the day. Fast forward over 2,000 years to the 1930s. Mountain troops are using hemp rope to climb higher than before. But hemp had a fatal flaw.
Prior to World War II, most climbing rope was a hemp rope, a natural fiber that could be twisted and braided together, and this is what most climbers used. But as a natural fiber, it was prone to wear, and it could tear and break suddenly.
With no elasticity at all, even if the hemp didn't break, it could be lethal all the same.
Climbers joke that we're not so worried about falling, we're worried about stopping. The concept of being caught by something this thin, when you're going fast and stopped immediately because it doesn't stretch, you can imagine the kind of harm it might do. In fact, it would probably break your back if you fell much more than about 10 or 15 feet.
As the 1940s dawned, the 10th Mountain Division were preparing to get vertical on the mountainous battlefields of World War II. These formidable barriers couldn't be assaulted by armored divisions, bypassed with airlifts, or smashed by strategic bombing. The only way was up, with ropes, boots, a backpack, and gritty determination. One slip, one malfunction, and climbers would be plunging to their deaths. The hemp rope was simply too risky to rely on. A new fiber was needed, and the DuPont Company came up with just the solution. A material as strong as steel, but as fine as a spider's web. Nylon.
This is a modern, dynamic nylon climbing rope. It's got an inner core that's extremely strong and stretchy, and then it's got an outer sheath that is mostly there to protect the core where the strength is held.
By absorbing the impact of a falling soldier, nylon rope meant that extreme warriors were no longer hanging by a thread.
It will always stretch to keep the forces that impact your body within reason. So you can fall the full length of this rope and still not have the rope do you harm.
Get up the rope!
Today, Special Forces use some of the best mountaineering equipment available. Their proficiency rivals the best climbers in the world. Rob Pincus trained special forces such as the Navy SEALs and U.S. Marine Corps for just this type of terrain. Here in the Colorado Rockies, 7,000 feet above sea level, ex-Navy SEAL John Evans will demonstrate how to rappel down the cliff's vertical face, carrying a weight of over 80 pounds.
As he gets to this ledge here, what he's going to actually do is he's going to get his center of gravity down below the rock ledge that when his feet come off, his head and gear are clear. He's not doing this for fun. He's doing this to get from point A to point B. He needs to be intact and have all of his gear intact when he reaches the bottom of this canyon.
Tightly secured to avoid entanglement, John is carrying everything he needs to destroy the enemy.
He's got his rifle in the back here on a drag bag where it's completely secure and away from everything else he's got. He's also got spare ammunition, communications gear, some medical equipment, whatever else he would need for this particular mission strapped onto the front. He's sitting here with probably an extra between 80 and 100 pounds of gear.
For larger scale mountain operations, ropes just won't swing it. You can't carry a 200-pound howitzer up a rock slope using raw manpower. That's why armies throughout history have turned to beasts of burden. Pack animals capable of navigating slopes with heavy loads.
In the American Army, the 10th Mountain Division was a little unusual. By 1944 and 1945, most of the Army was mechanized, but the 10th Mountain Division was still stuck with 4,000 horses and mules. This was necessary in order to haul their equipment down these mountain paths and the mountain roads that were out there that were not transportable by a Jeep or a truck.
Fast forward to the 21st century, and armies are still using pack animals in mountain warfare. Where men and machines can't go, mules rule.
I know for a fact that some U.S. Special Forces soldiers were undergoing mule skinner training when 9/11 happened, and they were ordered for deployment to Afghanistan. And of course, it proved to be very, very useful training.
There you go, bring that up. Going to the right.
The mule may kick ass in the mountain, but it's analog technology. To get digital on today's asymmetric battlefields, you need a beast of burden that's less unpredictable. A beast that can get men up the mountain in seconds and flatten the enemy. A beast with blades.
Ever since Vietnam, helicopters have transformed how we fight.
Extreme warriors live on the edge and fight through the pain. Sub-zero temperatures, driving snow, frozen earth, frozen bodies, frozen guns. These guys don't just live at the limits, they fight them. To take the battle into the mountains, armies face serious logistical challenges. Soldiers, supplies, ammunition, and artillery pieces have to be transported up treacherous passes and vertical ravines. During World War II, most armies used mules and sheer legwork, but not the Germans. They pioneered the use of helicopters in mountain operations. The Fokker Achilles FA-223 Drach was a serious evolution.
Germany was very advanced in rotary wing developments at the beginning of the Second World War, and they developed the FA-223 as a transport type helicopter to move heavy artillery around in the Alps.
With a maximum ceiling of 7,600 feet, this twin rotor beast could quickly airlift men and equipment. No climbing, no exposure, no unnecessary loss of life. The future of mountain transport had arrived, only to disappear when American planes took out the production line.
It could have been a very successful helicopter, but the Allies kept bombing the factory, and as fast as they built them, we were destroying them.
21st century, helicopters have established themselves as the primary means of transportation in mountain warfare, taking elite troops further, faster, and higher. The U.S. Army UH-60 Black Hawk has a maximum ceiling of 18,700 feet, more than double the ceiling of the German Drach. Operational duties at these altitudes do bring new problems. Problems that can result in the loss of multi-million dollar equipment and irreplaceable human lives.
The altitude definitely takes its toll on you. The air's thinner, there's a lot of wind. The helicopter doesn't perform quite as well. It's not as agile. It's a lot easier to run out of power.
Today's U.S. aviators are fighting in the highest terrain in the history of American warfare. More than 49% of Afghanistan lies above 6,500 feet. Pilots at these altitudes are playing Russian roulette.
Difficult environment, not just for the human beings involved, but for the helicopters. They weren't really designed to fly at those altitudes.
Okay, clear to depart.
here at the High Altitude Aviation Training Site in Colorado. Some of the most skilled mountain helicopter pilots disagree with that assessment.
It's not the machine that can't work there. You just have to understand the limitations of your aircraft at those altitudes.
Here, they teach pilots to understand their power limitations at altitude.
All right, power requirements. If you'll take the controls.
The thinner air at high altitudes reduces the amount of lift on the rotor blades. The engine doesn't develop as much power because of the thinner air and the decreased atmospheric pressure.
Coming to this school teaches them how the environment, the wind, the altitude, and the terrain, and how the mountains and all that is going to affect the helicopter and what they can anticipate.
More power here.
Training also focuses on storms and high winds, which can be deadly. Wind sweeps over hills at terrifying speeds, and for pilots, reading them is a skill that their life depends on.
Judging wind speed and direction is a major thing that we teach people to do here. We'll learn how the wind flows around different terrain features, shapes, sizes, and what kind of effect that it has.
Expect this thing as you get closer to swirl around right here, a little bit of wrap around. This is going to hold you up, and then it's going to drop you a little bit.
If you blindly fly through this kind of terrain without recognizing what the wind is going to do, then you're dancing with death.
There's certain times where on one side of the ridgeline, you shouldn't be there. The other side is very safe to be there. And the enemy's not always on the good wind side.
The effects of altitude on rotors and engines is a real and present danger. But for the extreme troops who jump out onto the mountain, there's an even greater killer. Silent and invisible, altitude sickness can strike down the toughest troops.
Altitude sickness is a configuration of symptoms that occur at high altitude. And it's due to the lack of oxygen in the air.
Lifted up mountains in a matter of minutes, soldiers are vulnerable to a range of debilitating symptoms. At just 8,000 feet, the first signs of altitude sickness can appear. Nausea, dizzy spells, and a shortness of breath. The higher you climb, the worse it gets. In extreme cases, pulmonary or cerebral edema can occur, a fatal swelling and accumulation of liquid in the brain or lungs.
When acute mountain sickness progresses to pulmonary edema or cerebral edema, as the lungs and the brain begin to fill up with fluid, they can no longer function properly and ultimately can result in death.
Even in its mildest form, it can hinder a soldier's effectiveness, making him disorientated, indecisive, and a danger to his comrades on the battlefield.
When people go to altitude, there's less oxygen, really to fuel the brain's activity. People won't be at the top of their game. They won't be feeling well. Their cognitive performance will be decreased as well. It's a very dangerous game.
At sea level, or at the top of Mount Everest, the air we breathe contains just over 20% oxygen. But at higher altitude, the density of molecules decreases proportionally. The result? At altitude, the air is thinner. Today, the special forces in the U.S. Army are feeling its effects on the high mountains of Afghanistan.
They've come back to us and they said, we're the best equipped and best trained army in the world, and we're getting our asses kicked by a guy running around in a pair of sandals and a cigarette hanging out of his mouth. And the reason we're losing is because he's perfectly at home at 11 or 12,000 feet, whereas our troops are not.
Soldiers that aren't ready for battle are a liability. And every day spent acclimatizing is another day the bad guys draw breath and wreak havoc.
It's been proven again and again that conventional troops should not be deployed to the mountains without acclimatization. 10 to 15 days is what would be most desirable.
Extreme troops take the battle to the roof of the earth and through the teeth of Arctic blasts. Isolated, exposed, they fight in the certain knowledge that there's no easy retreat. In these situations, cold becomes their greatest enemy.
Severe frostbite, where you've frozen your tissue right through the flesh and muscle to the bone, is cause for amputation.
Soldiers have many enemies. Death can come fast and hard in ways you never expected. But in extreme cold and snow, there are unseen terrors, invisible assassins, and they have names. Frostbite, hypothermia, exposure, pneumonia. If the enemy doesn't kill you first, one of these will.
The biggest enemy in mountain warfare are the elements.
If you're fighting up a mountain or in sub-zero temperatures, simply keeping yourself alive suddenly become extraordinarily difficult.
Welcome to the Death Zone. Fast forward to the 21st century, and extreme cold is still a killer on the battlefield. Norway, and British sniper Frank Fletcher is on an Arctic warfare exercise. It's routine stuff. His unit are learning how to live and fight in freezing temperatures. But in a few hours, he'll be close to death.
We've just been in a mock battle, so we're all a bit sweaty. So the sergeant major said, put your warm clothing on, which everybody did. And then we sort of waited and waited.
The men were waiting for a helicopter airlift back to base. It didn't show. It wasn't part of the plan. Now Frank and his buddies were exposed, their body temperatures dropping by the minute.
The temperature kept dropping and dropping. I think it was about minus 20 this time. So everybody started to sort of break off into little groups. And everyone was sort of huddled up together, and it just got colder and colder.
Their bodies were slowly switching off. Hypothermia, the most deadly Arctic predator, was taking hold.
Everybody just started shutting down, and I remember feeling really warm on my clothing. I didn't want to move. I was quite happy just to sit there, you know, and I didn't want to move.
The fact that he could no longer feel the cold meant his body was focusing its remaining resources on keeping his vital organs alive. Death was just minutes away. Then salvation came, an angel with rotors.
And all of a sudden, this helicopter appeared out of nowhere, and someone shouted, get up. But if it had been left there longer with no cover like that, I think guys would have died.
Frank was lucky. He and a small patrol could escape in a chopper and warm up at base camp. When whole armies get caught out in the freezing cold, it's a different story. In these conditions, thousands of men can be lost. Rewind to World War II, the Eastern Front, and the German army are at the gates of Moscow. One last push, and Soviet Russia will become Hitler's greatest trophy. But then, Mother Nature saves the motherland. Russia gets slammed by the worst winter in recorded history. And a Nazi war machine grinds to a halt. The Germans were caught in an icy embrace, a frozen fist that was choking the life out of its men, machines, and their morale.
I often think that if you had to pick a campaign hard to exceed in military history for its abject misery, I think that first winter on the Eastern Front for Germans who weren't ready for cold weather must have been the worst.
Daily temperatures fell to 40 degrees below zero. German soldiers had not been issued with warm winter clothing. Hitler believed the invasion would be over by winter. He was wrong. Now his men were sitting in trenches, trying not to die of cold.
The Germans were still fighting in their summer uniforms. They didn't have winter clothing, so soldiers froze to death. They suffered from hypothermia.
Their boots had got metal studs in, which transmitted the cold straight through to the foot. Their weapons didn't work, so the efficiency of the German army fell right off. Conversely, the Russians were much, much better fitted to cope with cold weather because they did it all the time.
The German suffering increased when the Soviets began pushing them back. Conducting defensive operations in open country around the turn of the year, the 6th Panzer Division was sustaining 800 frostbite casualties a day.
Holding a position outside became almost impossible. Sentries froze. Men simply died at their posts, died in trenches.
Frostbite kicks in at 32 degrees Fahrenheit or below. The skin's blood vessels narrow to help provide greater blood flow to the rest of the body. But less blood flow means less oxygen, which can lead to cell death and the flesh physically freezing.
Frostbite is the actual freezing of human tissue. Generally, it happens in the extremities. The body tends to pull blood flow to the core and to the brain, to the essential organs. That leaves the extremities with less and less and less circulating blood and a higher propensity for freezing. Severe frostbite, full thickness frostbite, where you've frozen your tissue right through the flesh and muscle to the bone, is cause for amputation.
With a hand or foot severely frostbitten or even amputated, your days as an extreme warrior are over.
Frostbite was probably the greatest disabler of a mountain soldier. If you got your hands cold, you can't hold or fire your weapon. If your feet are injured, it's very difficult to ski or climb a mountain. So that's one of those things that immediately you are taught to prevent.
Cold is a killer for your hands, for your feet, for your whole body, and also for your weapon. Weaponry and equipment is as much at risk to the cold as the human body. And when your gun freezes up, you're in some serious trouble.
Cold weather affects weapons in a lot of different ways. One of which is that weapon will freeze shut and you just can't work it.
Frozen weapons also posed a physical danger to men trying to fire them. In many cases, human flesh and ice-cold metal would fuse together.
When the bullets started flying, I put my rifle up to my shoulder to shoot, and my rifle stuck to my cheek. And so my buddy was beside me, said, "Keep firing, I'll blow on your cheek." And that's exactly what happened. He blew on my cheek and told him if I could get my rifle away.
Fast forward to the 1980s, and a British rifle manufacturer took on the challenge of creating a bolt-action sniper rifle that wouldn't freeze, wouldn't jam, wouldn't get you killed. The Accuracy International AW.
It's the first weapon we design with Arctic warfare in mind.
The team at Accuracy International had the task of making and testing a weapon that will withstand temperatures of minus 40 degrees. No mean feat.
We had to put the weapon in a large fridge overnight, take it out and literally shoot the thing when it was all covered in frost. First off, it didn't work because we couldn't undo the bolt. So we had to change the tolerances on all the moving parts within the bolt.
Ice was preventing the weapon from firing. They needed to find a solution. The breakthrough came when the designers put an ice groove around the chamber and barrel.
On the bolt body itself, we had to put various grooves like this, so as you actually manipulated the bolt, it would scrape the ice out of the mechanism.
The resulting AW bolt-action rifle can withstand Arctic temperatures of minus 40 degrees. Camouflaged and deadly accurate, it's a genuine Sub-Zero hero. Today, extreme warriors are the best of the best. Elite soldiers handpicked from the most elite special forces units in the world. They are constantly evolving to tackle the most extreme terrain on the planet.
I can see extreme warriors being just as important in the next century as they were over the previous one.
On the mountains, kicking ass. Great job.
Drawn together, the branches on the Extreme Warriors family tree reflect their unique genesis. From Alexander the Great's fearless climbers to Arctic warriors carrying advanced sniper rifles. From howitzers carried up mountains by donkeys to Black Hawk helicopter pilots waging war in the highest peaks in the world. They are extreme warriors.